Hello, and welcome to the webinar, Protecting What Makes Your Wine Special Legally. My name is Michael Kaiser. I'm the Director of Public Affairs for Wine America in Washington, D.C. And today we're going to talk about some social, or I should say some intellectual property issues when it comes to wineries and what wineries need to do to protect their social, their intellectual property. Okay, social media on the brain, apparently. What makes your wine attractive to consumers? However you define it, it needs to be protected. And today we're going to talk about how to protect your product and brand. Joining me today is Carl Davis and Joshua Tropper. They work for Baker Donelson, a law firm in Atlanta, Georgia. Both of them specialize in intellectual property, and that's where their practice is focused. And they are, like I said, they work for a firm called Baker Donelson. Baker Donelson is a supplier member of Wine America, and they're a law firm based in Atlanta as well as other offices across the country that specialize in legal, regulatory, and public policy law. Their clients include small and large wineries all over the U.S. and abroad. Lawyers in several of their offices have provided a wide range of services to wineries such as business organization, contracting for employment, insurance, litigation, real estate, securities, and our topic today, trademark issues. Now, please, if you have any questions, please feel free to write them down and type them in as we proceed through the webinar, and we will try to answer them at the end. And if we don't get to your question, please feel free to email us at your leisure after the presentation, and the PowerPoint will be available for you after the presentation as well. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Carl to begin our presentation.
Thank you very much. Baker Donelson thanks you for attending this webinar. Also, we thank you, Wine America, for inviting us to talk with you about protecting ideas. We have some attendees from companies other than wineries, but the general principles we discussed today can be applied to those companies as well. Joshua Tropper will talk about trademarks and branding later in this presentation, and I'm going to note some branding as well. The law provides different ways of protecting ideas. Trademarks can be thought of, or brands can be thought of, as generally consumer perceptions as to the source and quality of the goods or services that a consumer is seeking to purchase. Trade secrets relate to things or something you do secretly that gives an economic benefit. And then patents, the concept of patents protects inventions of processes and equipment. Trade secrets are generally state law, and this provision, this summary I'm showing you here is based on Georgia Code, where a trade secret is something that you know or do and you derive or can derive economic benefit that would be of economic benefit to someone else, but the information is not generally known, or if it is known to others, it's not known that you're using it in order to obtain that economic benefit as to the product or the service that you're providing in relation to that trade secret. It also is something that's not readily ascertainable by others by proper means. You can't look at the product or the information about the product and know what was done or used to arrive at the product. You can't reverse engineer from the product back to the information. In other words, take a machine apart and figure out how it works or operates. If you buy some equipment, that can be taken apart. So a company buying a machine can take it apart and determine how it's assembled and how it's made. A bottle of wine, generally we know how wine is made, but we don't know how this particular wine was made. In addition, the trade secrets need to be subject to reasonable efforts to maintain that secrecy. There is a Uniform Trade Secrets Act, which was promulgated in order to harmonize the law across multiple states. This Uniform Trade Secrets Act, as you can see, defines trade secret, again, derives independent economic value, not generally known or being readily ascertainable by proper means, and is subject of efforts that are reasonable to maintain the secrecy. This Uniform Trade Secrets Act has been adopted by 48 states. New York, North Carolina, and Massachusetts have not adopted this, but they have state laws governing trade secrets. The idea is to harmonize the law across multiple states for companies that are operating in different states, but also to protect against the improper apprehension of trade secret information. Something that's going to be a trade secret is something you know or do. Again, it may be information that's known to others, but it's not known that you're using that information. And the purpose of the use of that information is to obtain an economic benefit. For example, if you have a process for making wine, you may have steps or materials that differentiate your wine from other wineries or other products, and that process, those steps and that method may be protectable as a trade secret. You may have some equipment that you've developed that does something you find beneficial, and rather than manufacture additional machines and sell them to others, you leave it in a hidden place in a closed room behind a screen with limited access so that you can maintain the machine and its operation as a trade secret. This will be some of the questions issues we talk about when we start looking at should we take this and patent it as opposed to keeping it as a trade secret. It's also important for trade secrets to make reasonable efforts for secrecy. Particularly, you need to limit the access. I think the primary question on this is who has the need to know, and why are they wanting to know that information? So you're limiting access to the information itself. You're limiting access to the process that someone is carrying out that implements that trade secret. If you have a machine that you're using and it's not going to be marketed to others, but you're using in your process, you're going to limit access to that location and to the persons who have access to the machine for carrying out that trade secret. Documents are going to be marked confidential or secret. We recommend non-disclosure agreements as to employees, part of an employee agreement. And third parties, if they're coming in for some reason, why does that outside third party need to see either the machine or the process? And particularly, you're going to want to require execution of a non-disclosure agreement if they're inspecting or looking at processes or equipment that you consider to be trade secret. You're going to maintain your records securely, and you're going to discuss with your employees the importance of the trade secret and why it's important to keep it confidential and within the company. Wineries, I just made a list generally of areas of a winery business that might be subject of trade secrets. You might have a proprietary method of handling the grapes, certainly your source of grapes, your storage, your preparation for processing, preparation of fermenting, bottling, storage of casks and bottles, pending aging. And then business information, such as customer lists, sources of grapes, and that type of information is the type of information that can be maintained as a trade secret of the company. The purpose of having these trade secrets is obtaining an economic benefit. So you use it. You use it in your business of manufacturing wine, but you can also use it in branding. Coca-Cola is famous for its cola concentrate secret that is known to very few individuals. There was a court case where a judge wanted Coca-Cola to disclose its secret formula, and they just flatly said they're not going to do it. Kentucky Fried Chicken, Colonel's secret blend of herbs and spices. So So in advertising, you can market the concept of we have this proprietary process that we use to make our wine special. But that advertising and the disclosure doesn't tell the ingredients, if you will, of what that trade secret is. This is from the website for Kentucky Fried Chicken. It's got their trademarks. They call it the original, and they've got a paragraph talking about the 11 herbs and spices. And let me just bring you up a larger presentation of that, where on their website they're talking about their chicken seasoned with our secret blend of 11 herbs and spices. The information's general. It provides that advertising feature of we've got something special here that makes us distinctive, but it's not disclosing what the 11 herbs and spices are, what amounts, what ratios, how maybe a particular herb or spice is handled before combining it into the blend. Doesn't tell anything about the blend, what is the sequencing, doesn't tell anything about the sources of it. It just says we've got this blend of 11 herbs and spices. Let me note while we're talking about this, we mentioned social media. Be cautious in your posting of activities and photographs onto social media. A tweet, for example, another long day nitrogenizing the grapes. I'm just assuming that a nitrogen process is maybe a trade secret using. So by tweeting that, you're disclosing information about the conduct of your business, the activities of your business. So you need and your employees need to be cautious in what they're putting out on social media. Suppose you have some equipment that you're using that you think provides a benefit, you don't show it to other people. Well, if you put a photograph of that machine or that equipment online, you say, here's our machine for our secret process. I question, and I wonder, and you should ask the same question, can someone reverse engineer the machine based on a photograph and knowing what that machine's supposed to accomplish? It's something you need to keep in mind when you're looking at social media questions. So in branding, we're going to take that trade secret feature we have and we're going to market it in order to promote the idea of distinctiveness of our wine. I just made up a trademark vouchs for providing a distinctive aromatic flair that was developed over long years of winemaking. Maybe I should go into the advertising business. But we're not telling what that process is, what it does, or how, or the equipment, or how it works. So let's see how one winery is doing this. Conundrum Wines, it's a blended wine, but it's not known generally to the public how it's done. It's a conundrum, if you will. So I took a look at their website, and yes, it's a question of what do they do and how they do it. And they're saying that it all began, we would mix wines to find the perfect glass to pair with a meal. So Conundrum explains that the wine is mixed, doesn't tell you what wines they're using or what ratio they're doing. They're also promoting what they do, but not the specifics. This is also from their webpage. Basically, the grapes are sourced, but which suppliers, what ratios? That information is not disclosed. The information that's provided is generally public. Napa Valley, well, it's known for wineries and grape production. Monterey, certainly known for agriculture and grapes. And so their website provides the connection between the trade secret that they have of how do they do the mix, what are they mixing in order to arrive at their branded wine. Briefly, in summary, trade secrets in practice, use the trade secret, not readily ascertainable by others, by proper means, deriving an economic benefit, and efforts to maintain the trade secret. On the other hand, you may have an invention and want to seek patent coverage for that invention. The Constitution provides for patents, that in order to promote the progress of science and useful arts, Congress is permitted to provide laws for securing for limited times to inventors the exclusive right to their discoveries. One of the requirements for an invention to be patentable is that it be useful for something. The invention also has to be new. It also has to be non-obvious over the prior art or things that are previously known. Patent application also requires timely filing in order to obtain patent coverage. Patents can be directed to processes, a step for doing or making something, can be directed to machines and articles of manufacture or equipment. Generally, in seeking patent coverage, the patent attorney is spending his time arguing with the office, the patent office, about what are the differences between the invention and the prior art, and why are those differences meaningful such that the claimed invention should be patentable. Patent rights are exclusions. The grant of a patent gives the patent owner the right to exclude others from making, using, selling, or offering to sell the claimed invention. Without getting into technical issues or reasons, but it's an exclusion, the right to stop somebody from doing what you claim your invention to be. And the claimed invention is really the subject matter that you believe to be the invention. And I refer to it generally as a parts list. What does it take? What combination of elements or steps do we need to put in there in order to make an operating version of the claimed invention, whether it's a process or some equipment? For example, if you had a process for producing Marmello wines where you're crushing the fruits, pressing the fruits to remove the juices, adding gelatin, precipitating a compound, adding yeast, and fermenting, there's a method claim directed to a process for producing a wine. You may have a machine that does all those steps or parts of it. You may have a crusher, a press to extract the juice, a metering device to provide an additive from a supply, a precipitator, a second metering device to add yeast, and then a fermentation tank. So the claim sets forth the elements of the steps or the equipment in order to make an operative version of that invention. The thing to keep in mind, as distinguished a trade secret, is that patenting involves an exchange of information. In exchange for telling the public in a document how to make and use this invention, and if it's patentable, then the government's going to grant you the right to exclude others for a limited period of time. And so there's this idea in patents of full disclosure of how to practice the invention. Whereas in trade secrets, it's built internally, and you're keeping it confidential and maintaining the secrecy of it. Let me talk briefly just about the patenting process. An application is written and filed with the patent office, and then the claims are examined as to novelty and non-obviousness, and you get a report of the examination. And if it's found not patentable, then you can file a response to that to either argue about the prior art that's cited in rejecting the claims or amend the claims to distinguish over the prior art so that you can clearly set forth what the important aspect of your invention is to distinguish it from the prior art. If it appears patentable, then the patent would issue in due course. Even if you took steps to file a patent application for an invention, depending on how you file it, it may or may not be published. If it's not published and the claims are rejected as not patentable, you can still maintain it as a trade secret. But that decision needs to be made early in the process of seeking patent coverage. So you need to talk with your lawyers about what the invention is and why you think it can be a trade secret or why you think you want to publicly disclose it if the patent is granted. Depending on how you set it up when you initially file the application, if it's not allowed and it's not published, then it can remain confidential and as a trade secret. Let me just give you an example. Here's a way of treating grapes before juicing. And the idea is we're going to maintain the grapes in a special atmosphere for 3 hours and 20 minutes at a specific temperature, and that atmosphere is at temperature prior to inserting the grapes. And this is a technique that we developed after long and many years of experimenting and determining this is the a great way to make a wonderful tasting wine that's fruity and flavorful. Well, we could protect that with trade secrets by limiting the access to that information and using it in production of a wine. You could also write a patent claim direct to this process. I'm not saying this claim's patentable, it's probably not, but bringing the treatment zone to a predetermined temperature, disposing or placing the fruit articles within that treatment zone, and then maintaining the fruit articles within the treatment zone for a predetermined period. From a trade secret standpoint, the person preparing the grapes, they need to know. But the shipping department, they don't need to know that this process is done. They don't need to see the equipment that's doing it. If you write a patent application about it, the public's going to know if the patent is issued or if it gets published. Let me show you some quick examples of some patents. Here's a sensory aroma glass. This is a utility patent for a structure or a process used for evaluating the aroma of a wine. Here's a bottle. It's a design patent. Design patents protect the ornamental appearance. What does a thing look like? What does this bottle look like? One of the inventors in this case is Francis Ford Coppola. So if you're not making movies, you can make wine and bottles. Here's another bottle, another design patent for a bottle. Yep, another bottle. Here's a utility patent for a reclosable closure system. Here's a process for producing wine. It's a utility patent again. Utility patent for a process of extracting
That's right.
Oleic acid. Sorry. Trade secrets, well, like everything, it's got advantages and disadvantages. Secret information, not readily ascertainable or reverse engineerable, created, maintained internally with efforts to maintain the secrecy. It's continuous, as long as you keep it secret. The risk is that someone develops something similar to trade secret or develops the trade secret independently. And I guess a good example is Coca-Cola and Pepsi. They both have secret formulas for their cola beverages, but they're not the same. Patenting, public, discloses how to make and use. There's a cost associated with obtaining patent rights. Patent grant is determined by the government, and it provides a limited period of time to exclude. So now what? Well, think about your processes. Are you taking reasonable steps to limit access? Are you documenting your secrecy? Is it winery specific, either the equipment or the process? If it's not, you might consider the opportunities to license through a patent. Is the information not readily ascertainable by proper means? You can't reverse engineer it. You can't determine what was done just by looking at the product. For new or recent developments, do you want to be in a position to exclude others from using it? Is the process or equipment generally applicable to other industries, that there might be a market for it? Is it a device or a product that's readily reverse engineered? If so, you might be thinking in the lines of patent rather than trade secret for that. So we come back to Kentucky Fried Chicken. Here's their recipe. It's a trade secret, of course, but since I worked at Kentucky Fried, you start with chicken. You start with 25 pounds of flour, take a cup of salt, a cup of pepper, and then you've got to reach up on the shelf and get one bag of the Colonel's secret blend of 11 herbs and spices. And there's trade secrets and patents in a nutshell.
Thank you, Carl. For those of you who noticed the mention, both Michael and Carl have been talking a little bit about in their introductions of the social media. Read your weekly bulletins from Wine America, because we are not the ones who are giving you the advice on that today, but Wine America is providing very good and useful information on the subject. My part of today's discussion is about trademarks. And so, of course, the first question is exactly what is a trademark? And if you haven't dabbled in this field of law, then you may have some misconceptions, because the purpose of trademark is to prevent confusion in the marketplace, which means that anything that can distinguish your goods or services from the goods or services from another supplier can serve as a trademark. And so it is not limited to the obvious. This is just an example, a quotation from a U.S. Supreme Court decision from 1879 explaining that trademark law goes back farther than we do, that long before Congress ever started worrying about defining what a trademark was and trying to enact legislation to protect it. It was already built into the law in this country. An example of the sort of thing that could be trademarked is the obvious example, the company's name. A lot of people think that registering the company's name with the your local Secretary of State, if you incorporate, or the approvals you get from TTB give you the right to use that name, that's a mistake. All that does is say that they are letting you use it, but if somebody else is already using it somewhere else, then it does not give you any trademark rights at all. In order to have trademark rights, you actually have to use the name, which is why the next example is that of the name of a winery. This one was, Inglenook was registered in 1934. It happens that the winery bore the same name as the company that established the winery. That's not always true, because the trademark can also just be the brand name of a particular wine that may not have any relationship to the vineyard or the winery or the company that produced it, such as one of my longtime favorites, the Deep Space Wine brand for Klingon blood wine. I suspect that this was registered in 1999 to capitalize on the popularity of the television programs. Paramount getting into the wine business, I'm not entirely sure was a good idea. Mr. Coppola has done it much more successfully. It can also be, a trademark could also just be your slogan, such as Palmasson's, we will sell no wine before it's time. Consider if you're still thinking about what's a trade secret, well, what's its time? Thank you, Carl. They don't say, and the for those of you who remember when Orson Welles was promoting Masson wines with this slogan, the joke was, we will sell no wine before it's bottled. I'm not even sure that was entirely true. There's also one of my very favorite trademarks is Gallo's old, by golly, by Gallo. This was registered in 1942, and believe it or not, it was the registration was maintained for 40 years. I don't know how long they were actually using this. By the time I got into wine, it was long since relegated to the dustbin of history, but that is a trademark. It was a registered trademark of Ian J. Gallo. The label design, here's another old timer. Cook's was registered in 1896. So we are not the first people to suggest that you might want to think about registering your trademarks. One last and very important note, you have to be very creative to be able to come up with, to exploit this opportunity when you're in the wine business, but you don't have to be able to see it for it to function as a trademark. It is legal, not easy, but legal, to trademark an aroma, a sound. I've never yet heard of anyone register, a color is visible though. I've never heard of anybody trying to register a flavor, but if you can do it, and if you could persuade the trademark examiner that the flavor of your wine is so distinctive that anyone tasting it would know that's yours, then legally it should be registrable. Whether it does you any good to register something of that particular nature or not is another question. Now, that's the sort of the range of things that could serve as trademarks. There are other things which are generally not suitable to be trademarks, such as generic terms. You could not register wine or red wine as a trademark because there is a general sense, it's right in the trademark statute, that no one person should have a right, an exclusive right to ownership of what everybody else calls the product. Until the last year, it was not legal to register a scandalous or disparaging name, although some wineries use some scandalous or disparaging labels. They're not able to register them as trademarks until now. That's a new thing, but because it's so new, I don't have any examples of how it's been done successfully. Another category of mark that is normally not usable as a trademark, not registrable as a trademark, and yet people in the wine business worldwide do it, is a person's name. Now, if you look closely at this, you will see on the right side that it says Robert Mondavi is the name of a living individual whose consent is of record, because the trademark office is not going to allow you to register the name Joe Smith with the effect of preventing everybody else in the world named Joe Smith from using that name. There is a very competent and reasonably successful winemaker in Georgia by that name, but he's not been able to register it yet. Mr. Mondavi was able to, or at least his company was able to register his name because it had been using his name as a brand name for so long, and he was so successful and so famous that that wine lovers around the world did get to know that the words Robert Mondavi really did mean wine with that label, and not specifically necessarily the old gentleman by that name. So once his company was able to get that registration, this registration was issued in 1985, long after he had been in the business. He had already established success. Now, nobody named Robert Mondavi, even if it's really his name, can go into the wine business in that name, under that name. There are other examples. One of the one that comes to mind, I don't have a slide for it, but one, and there are many others, but William Hill pops to mind because I remember talking to William Hill very soon after he opened his new winery under a new name, after he had sold the original William Hill Winery and could no longer operate under his name. I suspect that in California there are a lot of people with that problem. In the rest of the world, in the rest of this country at least, it hasn't happened a lot yet, but it certainly can happen. Once your name it becomes valuable enough to become registered as a trademark, then it's going to be owned by your business, and if you sell the business, that means you've sold the name. It's not you anymore. Another category of thing that you would think might be suitable to be a trademark but is not is the descriptive name, such as summer wine. It's not quite as bad as a generic name that they won't let you register at all. The trademark office maintains what they call a supplemental register, which essentially keeps track of people who want to establish trademark rights in trademarks that they are not allowed to register on the normal principal register. But it does keep track of them, and it has the primary benefit of being in the registry so that they won't register anybody else, even on the supplemental register, with the same name. And people who are out there looking to see what names are available and what are not would say, oh, Chateau Elan has already registered summer wine, so I can't use that. So the supplemental register does some good. Geographic place names are another category. Back in 1864, the English Court of Chancery had to resolve a dispute by two people who were importing wines from Burgundy, decided that the first person to import wine from Burgundy, labeling it Burgundy, even though they had a 20-year head start on anybody else from that market, still could not claim exclusive rights to it, because Burgundy was a sufficiently large place that anybody from Burgundy ought to be able to use the name. Within 5 years, somebody importing Portuguese wine into England came up with a better solution. There is an area in Portugal known as Quinto Seixo. Please forgive my bad Portuguese if I'm mispronouncing it. But the first company to export Quinto Seixo wine to England used the words Quinto Seixo with a large emblem of a crown on its label and on its cork, and advertised itself as Crown Quinto Seixo. So the next person to export wine from the Quinto Seixo district into England made the mistake of also using a crown image on their cork and label, and the courts said, no, that's not really, you have the right to say Quinto Seixo, but not with a crown, because that really is going to be causing confusion. To bring this into modern times, when I first moved out to California in 1983, I was already a big fan of wines from the southern Napa Valley produced by a place called Stag's Leap, and it was only after I moved to California, that I realized that there were two wineries bottling wines under the label Stag's Leap, and to this day, unless I'm actually looking at one of the labels, I can't tell you whether the one I love is Stag's Leap Wine Cellars or Stag's Leap Winery, but I at least do know there is a difference. This is the sort of thing that you really, really would like to discourage. If you are the first person in your particular neighborhood, or you're the one who persuades the world to recognize an appellation for you, you're probably best not using that as your brand name, because the next person to use the same geographic designation or the same appellation can create confusion, and you do not want confusion. Having gotten through those examples of what is and is not and can be and should not be a trademark. These are basically the benefits of federally registering your trademark. The registration creates a presumption of validity, and presumption is a legal term of art that no lawyer can give you a good explanation for, but essentially it means that if you get into a fight about whether you own the trademark or not, a court is going to be more inclined to believe that you own it if, in fact, you've registered it. The second benefit listed there is that after 5 years, your ownership of the mark becomes incontestable, and that is much more important than the presumption, because that means that after you've been registered for 5 years, nobody can come along and try to rebut the presumption by saying, no, you don't own that mark. We do. We had it first. It's descriptive. It's generic even. It's just a person's name. It's fraudulent. Nobody can do any of those things. Once you've been registered for 5 years, unless you actually committed a direct fraud on the trademark office to get your registration in the first place, there are a couple of other exceptions, but they're even worse. Your mark is good. The third benefit of federal registration is nationwide priority. If you are not registered, you have trademark rights, but they are limited to the geographic area in which you are actually selling your wine, which means if you are a local winery with a small production, you're only selling to your neighborhood stores or to people who walk into your location and walk out with a case or two of wine in their trunk, then you may think it's not very important to have nationwide priority because you're only selling locally. However, most people, maybe I shouldn't say most, that's an empirical fact that I don't really know, but an awful lot of people who start out locally dream of expanding. And however many years later in the development of your life and your winery, you actually extend from local into regional or national distribution, it will be tremendous benefit if you have already federally registered so that you have nationwide priority long before you actually start using the mark nationwide. If you have any thoughts of selling your winery to one of the bigger players, especially if it's to one of the major conglomerates that may have nationwide or even worldwide distribution, then having your mark registered so that your rights are good nationwide can be of tremendous value. The fourth benefit is that you can actually apply to register a trademark before you start using it. So that you get into the books, you get priority as long as you actually complete the registration within what generally these days is 3 to 4 years after you originally apply, then your priority is valid and your ownership is valid as of the date of your application. So if you are thinking of producing a wine, a new wine under a new label, then, you know, maybe even before you're planting the grapes, or certainly before they get bottled and sold, you can already lay claims to your trademark rights if you register. If you do not register, you have no rights until you start selling. The last item on the list is the deterrent effect, and I think I mentioned that a minute ago when I was talking about the supplemental register. The deterrent effect is impossible to measure, but in many cases it is the single most valuable benefit of registering your trademark, and that's why even a supplemental registration is good, because people who understand the implications of trademark law will want not to choose a name that somebody else has already got rights in. And if you're there, if you're registered, if you've laid out your claim and anybody doing a search to see whether a name is available will find you, and anyone honest and decent who does a search and finds you will choose a different name for their own product. So registration can help avoid problems. Now the next question the slide is labeled "What is infringement?" And the answer is, if you understood and fully absorbed everything else I've said, probably pretty obvious. Infringing a trademark means use of the same or confusingly similar mark, honor in connection with the same or related goods, creating a likelihood of confusion. And that was why I started this part of the presentation by saying trademark law is all about preventing confusion in the marketplace. There's absolutely no trademark problem with Delta Dental, Delta Faucet, and Delta Airlines all having the same name, because nobody's ever going to suspect that an airline or a plumbing company would start competing with the other. Everybody knows that they come from different places. But if they are on the same types of goods or on sufficiently similar goods that the marketplace is likely to suspect that they come from the same source if they have the same name, then that's going to be a trademark infringement. The way you compare to consider what's too similar is, does it look the same? Does it sound the same? If it's a translation, the French and English or Italian or Spanish phrases or words that essentially all mean the same thing, as far as trademark law is concerned, they are the same thing. And the fourth one there is sort of a catch-all. If it creates the same overall commercial impression, if somebody walking into a store and asking for something, or seeing a name or on a restaurant wine list, or just chatting at a party with a friend, says something or sees something or hears something and thinks it's the other, then they're probably confusingly similar. Some examples. This one is extremely current. I don't know whether you can see whether the image is large enough to tell. The corks are labeled Bella Union. The bottle is labeled Union Wine Company. Whichever one went first sued the other one. And the case actually settled. There wasn't a decision, but the court said that's too hard to tell without taking evidence and consumer surveys as to whether they are confusingly similar or not, so I'm going to have to let the case go to the jury. And as soon as the court said that, the parties reached a settlement agreement, which is, unfortunately, I do not know the contents of. Like most settlement agreements, all you can tell is how the people behave in the market. You don't know what the terms really are. A rather older one would be the case in 1911, a dispute between Carmel Wine Company and California Winery. Both of them used on their label an image which was inspired by a biblical scene of two men carrying a staff between them, and one of the staffs had a large grape hanging from it, and the other had a cluster of grapes hanging from it. And whichever side went first sued the other one for infringement, and the court said that it is apparent without argument that the two marks are deceptively similar and that such a practice would lead to no end of confusion. So the difference between two men dressed like biblical characters carrying a grape and two men dressed like biblical characters carrying a cluster of grapes, too close to be tolerated. Don't ask me how I chose what order to present these in. There's one dispute from two very large wineries and two very successful wineries one that pictured a grape leaf design, very highly stylized, and a bottle that emphasized that design. The competitor produced a bottle with a similar relationship between the cork and the label, and similarly colored stylized grape leaves on the same color background in the label. And the court in that case said, it doesn't matter how similar they are, the idea of using a grape leaf of whatever color to promote wine is merely descriptive. It's too stock. Nobody can claim exclusive rights to use a grape leaf. So Kendall Jackson was turned down by that court. Then the this is just the excerpts from the court's decision in that case. Another case involving, or just a few other recent cases, the Gallo, E&J Gallo, that makes salami as well as wine due to historical reasons. The third brother, Ernest and Julio's third brother, wanted to use his own name, Joseph Gallo, to sell cheese, and the court said, no, cheese and salami and wine are all sold together in delis and gourmet shops, and therefore that's going to be confusingly similar. That was not permitted. So, of course, Joseph Jr. was allowed to sell his cheese, and you can still buy it, but it's but not under that name. Another Gallo problem was, did I skip a slide?
When, go back one.
Let me see. Maybe my, no, okay, I'm sorry. That was, that one slide covered three items. The Gallo, the second Gallo problem was with conflict with an energy drink called El Gallo, which, of course, if you read it in English, looks like it's El Gallo, and E and J were not amused. The court concluded that the idea that wine and energy drinks are too close together in the marketplace, that is being currently on appeal by the maker of El Gallo. The third one listed on that slide is the question of whether wine is closely enough related to apple juice or apple-based non-alcoholic beverages. It was clearly excluding hard cider, and that exclusion made all the difference in the world, so that the Canadian company Domaine Pinnacles was permitted to register Pinnacles for apple-based beverages, notwithstanding Franciscan's ownership of both Pinnacles and Pinnacle Ranches for wine. Then the White Oak case that shows that wine and vodka are sufficiently similar. I imagine white wine and vodka might be confusingly similar, but the White Oak Vineyards was able to get an injunction preventing the release of White Oak vodka. And the last example that I have, another very recent one, is that Anheuser-Busch was able to stop an Australian company who wanted to produce a wine called Wine Bud on the strength of their Budweiser and Bud trademark registrations for beer, because, as everyone knows, wine and beer are essentially the same thing. At least everybody who never drinks either of them knows that. So that's basically it. Unlike Carl's explanation of trademarks and of trade secrets and patents, where you can pretty easily tell you what the rules are, and you can usually even know what the result is going to be. If you think about these half a dozen examples I've just shown you, I don't think that anybody who hasn't actually done the research would be able to predict all of them correctly, which ones are too close and which ones aren't. And so really the bottom line is be careful. Do get a search. Do make sure that what you're doing is not being used by other people before you start doing it. And if you and if you're already doing it, then try to get it registered to keep other people from doing something similar. That's basically the summary of the trademark part of the presentation. And I think we've got a few minutes left for questions, if anybody has any.
All right, thank you,
since
guys.
Nobody wants to.
I don't
ahead,
see
Michael.
Any questions in the question and answer section. So, in the interest of time for everybody, I want to thank you all for participating. Again, these slides will be available to you. And if you do think of any questions after we sign off here, please email us. As you can see, the last slide should have our email contact on there. Yes, and you can feel free to give us a call as well. I want to, again, thank you all for participating. I want to particularly thank Carl and Joshua for Baker Donelson for giving such a great and thorough presentation. I hope it was all worth your while. And look for future webinars from us as we go down the road, and hopefully we'll have some more interesting topics for you. Again, thank you all very much, and we'll talk to you all soon. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.